This morning I woke up and the Lord told me, you need to share on the attitude of gratitude. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The attitude of gratitude. And this is what he was speaking to me. He said, you need to teach them. He said, so many of us, over time, we become unthankful. And he took me to the book of Romans, chapter 1. Romans chapter 1 describes the descent into lawlessness. And it begins by saying, being unthankful. So, their descent into lawlessness and sin begins with them being unthankful. What happens? Because when you're unthankful, after a while, you cease to recognize the hand of God in your life. You begin to see it as your own hard work, your own effort, and everything you've put in. Don't you find it amazing? David, years later, he begins with the Exodus from Egypt. And he begins listing all the way, crossing the Red Sea. He fed them manna. He comes all the way. Because when you begin to recognize where God has brought you from, what he has done, then you cannot fall into the attitude that, oh, I brought it to myself. I did all the hard work. I'm the one who made it happen. And you see, this must permeate every area of our lives. Let me tell you, let me give you an example of what usually happens in churches, in fellowships. When you've just come to visit a fellowship or a church for the first time, you are so blessed. You're so excited by what's going on there. You want to serve in some way possible. Then what happens is, after a while, you start complaining. After a while, you've forgotten the joy that brought you. You've forgotten how nice it was when you first came. So what happens is, let's say you came the first time. Let me use Breakthrough as an example. You came to Breakthrough the first time. Someone told you about it. You needed the power of God. You were hungry. So you come. And you come and we have fellowship and the Holy Spirit moves. The power hits you. You are down on the ground. You roll, whatever. You know, you get a word of prophecy. Hey, maybe you came with a pain and the pain goes and you're excited. You know, you want to even find some way to be part of it. How can I serve? How can I help, you know, keep this going and everything? Now, of course we love people, we welcome you. And what happens is this, after a while, of course, because when we end late, we know we tell people, well, we'll take you home. And that's, yeah, we like to make sure people get home safely and everything. But after a while, you begin to take certain things for granted. Before long, now you start complaining about which car they took you in. Kale, you see those people? For them, they take them in the nice van. Then for us, they put us in the old one. You are no longer grateful that they took you home. Now, there is a sense of entitlement. Those ones, the ones from there, the ones they put in the one which has air conditioning. You begin to get all these kinds of things. How come it is those ones who for them, you know, have you noticed? Pastor hugs those ones, but he doesn't hug us. As if you came to be hugged. And it begins slowly. Maybe once in a while, you know, you came and I got to know maybe something was happening. So, yeah, I said, okay, hey, are you all right? Okay. Oh, yeah, how come I didn't see you last week? Hey, you know, things were not all right. I'm like, oh, it's all right. I'll give you transport next week. Then I give you transport. Then the next week I don't give you transport, you complain. As if it's my job to give you transport. The truth is, we will have fellowship if you come or you don't come.
Hallelujah.
But this is what happens is, and this is what we do to God as well. After a while, we take for granted his goodness. We take for granted his love for us and his gifts to us. You become so used even to the miraculous that you no longer thank God when he does a miracle. It's, yeah. even when he shows up. In fact, I find it amazing. Ever watch people who've been in church a long time? Those who've been, who are new, when the power of God is moving, they're getting closer because they want a touch. The ones who've been around are running away from it. Because they are thinking how inconveniencing it is for them to fall down and get where they might get dirty. No longer do they value this whole, I want a touch from God, I came hungry, I need something. They've been in church for so long that they take the things of God for granted. I found it very interesting. You want to find a good example of it? You look at the music ministry in churches. It is very rare to find musicians who listen to the sermon. Hey. Once they are done playing, they disappear. Once they're done playing, when you're finishing the sermon, you're looking for them. Where is so and so? Where is so and so? They're at the canteen, they're drinking something. No, I mean, we find it. My friend, yeah? Hey, you know, you're thinking, at least keyboard prayers. You will find a drummer who prays. You find a drummer who prays. What? You come for the overnight. After they are done playing, that's it. In fact, the drummer has a nice way of hiding behind the drums and the sleeps. But what happens is we just begin to take God and the things of God for granted. Before, when you were fresh in God, you were excited to just be in the presence of God. Then you get so used, you're thinking, I know what's coming next. You're taking it so much for granted that even when the sermon starts, you think you know where it's going. It's even worse for those of you who serve closely to the ministers. Because somewhere, you've heard me preach that sermon. So when you go with me somewhere and I start somewhere, you're like, "Eyo najiulira." Eyo njimanyi. I've heard it. Yajiulira negundi. But you have no idea in which direction the Lord will lead me with the same sermon. What new nugget? Because for me, every time I preach the same sermon again, I get shocked. I'm like, "Hey, there's even this one and this one." And you go to a scripture you never quoted the other time. You go a certain direction you never went. But because you've gotten so used, the things of God, you're taking them simply. I woke up this morning and the Lord was emphasizing it to me. He said, "Noah, when people become unthankful, it is the beginning of the descent into lawlessness." And the thing we don't understand is the power that's in thanksgiving. I was reading and I was amazed. You go back and read in the book of Jonah. When Jonah is in the fish and he's praying, until he gave thanks, the Bible says when he, immediately after he gave thanks, the Lord commanded the fish to vomit him. The guy had been praying for 3 days. Until he came to the place of thanksgiving, he was still praying. But when he came to the place of thanksgiving, God immediately responded. When you see throughout the scriptures, you know, everywhere, in fact, even in Revelation, thanks is one of the things it lists that belongs to him. It says thanksgiving, it belongs to him. The scriptures emphasize thanks. I mean, I was looking today at scriptures concerning thanks and I was shocked. There are too many. You know, when you do search results, and then you can see 10 pages of search results. Just for the word thanks. Because God loves to be thanked.
Oh, yes.
But we take him for granted. We take his goodness, the things he does, for granted. And let me tell you, an attitude of ingratitude is deadly. Because it will flow. Once you are ungrateful to God, you will also become ungrateful to your friends, to your spouse, to everyone around you. You take everyone for granted. Let me tell you what happens when you develop that kind of attitude. Someone will lend you their car and you return it empty. Because you've gotten an attitude of, you know, you just think you're entitled. You get an attitude of entitlement. I used to find it interesting. You would go with people, and initially, when you started going with them, they just wanted an opportunity to serve. But because you, as a minister, you believe in the principles of God, yeah? The laborer is worthy of his reward and what? You start giving them love gifts. The day you don't, fire. Suddenly they are complaining. But when they first came, they just wanted an opportunity to serve. But somewhere along the way, they've now gotten to the place of feeling, I'm entitled. And you see it with Jonah. Jonah goes and sits, and he's waiting to see Nineveh destroyed. And God looks at him and says, man, the guy is sitting in the sun. Let me cause a tree to grow so that he has some shade. He's not the one who asked for the shade. God's the one who decided. When the shade dies, Jonah complains, as if in the first place he's the one who put it there. There's that attitude of, he can't even be at that place where he's like, Lord, I thank you for the days I had the shade. No, now you've not destroyed them. Even the Kalito shade I had, now you've caused it to die. There's that attitude of ingratitude has just swept in. It is amazing. Sometimes you find someone and they come and they say, you know, how can I be of help? What can I do? How can I serve? You know? And you look at them and you say, okay, maybe this is how you could serve. You have a car? Okay. Maybe you could be taking some people home. Like, oh yeah, yeah. And at first they're eager to do it. They don't even ask you for fuel. Then you start giving them fuel. Then one day, you know, for one reason or the other, maybe there's no money, you don't give them fuel. Ah, yeah. Do they know? Micah, I service it, I do what, and then they don't give me fuel. In the first place, you're the one who came and volunteered. Shet olaba sakata. Tell your neighbor, fire. Over the years in ministry, I've met many people like that. When I was saying earlier that I had this thing about young people coming to serve, and then you're like, It's because after a while, you've experienced so many of these things. Someone comes, they're eager, and you give them an opportunity to, and then, along the way, they just become a serial complainer. Now this, now the other, now this is not okay, now what? Now, and you're thinking, you know, I should have just left you at the other place where you were happy to come. Because now you are entitled. And you have a million complaints. You know what's amazing? In fact, what makes me laugh? We used to do MTR on campus, Mango Tree Revival. Under that tree, there was no guitar, there were no drums, there was nothing. We clapped our hands and we sang. And the Holy Ghost moved. Then we later, when you go places where there's a guitar and a keyboard and everything, you are complaining. Before we used to clap and sing. And the guy leading sometimes could be off key and flirting. But the Holy Ghost still moved. Today, you say, banana. Guy wa bass, ya nene sezo kusinza. How? How? Ngaruli wali projirina na ego sinza. Na yekati ya kule mesa. How? It's just an attitude of entitlement. Yeah, and then he says, how? We used to pray under a tree, and it would rain, and we would stay. Because we were that hungry for God. We were so hungry. Rain? How can rain chase me from the presence? You would stay and get wet. Because you're like, I am not missing God. Now, let the service extend by 30 minutes. We had appointments, we had plans. I've had God deal with me many times on this. I used to go to overnight. And those days, man, we were so broke. If the Kavandole didn't take you to off to Miracle Center for overnight, you were in trouble. But we were so hungry, you would walk from campus to get there. Figuring, maybe I'll catch it in the morning. For me, I was lucky, since I lived here in Lungudia, when I couldn't get, I come from church and come and sleep at home. If I miss the bus. But the thing is, we were that hungry. Huh? Then I saw people. When the buses started getting problems, they started complaining. The buses were just old. They started complaining and complaining and complaining, and some stopped coming. But in the first place, before they were just hungry for God, they would have walked. Now they have gotten entitled to the bus. Entitlement is a dangerous thing. We have to have an attitude where you're so thankful for everything God does. No wonder David writes, and he says, in the morning, they must give thanksgiving. And in the evening, they must also give thanksgiving. When he was establishing the order for how they should worship after bringing the ark in, he says, in the morning, they must give thanks, and in the evening, they must give thanks. And I thought about it, I said, in the morning, what are they giving thanks for? God hasn't yet done anything. They just woke up. They're giving thanks in advance for what he's going to do. And at the end of the day, they're now thanking him for what he has already done. Amen. And you can never run out of giving thanks. Man, there are things to give thanks for. Take some time. Sit down and make a list from your childhood up to today. You'll be amazed at what God has done. You'll be amazed at the things you had even forgotten that he did. The times you should have died, but you did not die. The times you should have dropped out of school, but you did not drop out of school. The times when your family could have been destroyed, but it was not. There are so many things we have to thank God for, but we are so forgetful. No wonder he says, and forget not. By the time God tells you not to forget, it's because he knows you are prone to forgetting. There are things that I look back now. I thank God that I have a nice little book in which I write every word of prophecy I get, every promise I hear from God and what. Because later when you go through, you realize, hey, this was fulfilled, this was fulfilled, this was fulfilled. And you start ticking off and ticking off and ticking off, and you realize God has done so many wonderful things. You see, if God needs a book of remembrance, so do you. Yeah. If God needs a book of remembrance, so do you. Get yourself a nice book of remembrance. Every time you get a word, write it there. Every time God does a miracle, write it there. Amen.
Amen.
Every time you get a word of prophecy, you hear something while you are praying, write it there. And then don't just write. Come back periodically and read through. You'll be amazed at what God has done. You'll be shocked and blown away. I look back, just 7 years ago when I look back. 7 years ago at the time I went to the US, things were tight. I was living with Raymond there. There were nights when we had nothing to eat. When I would walk from here to Rubaga Hospital there, because they had cheap chapatis opposite the hospital. 500 shillings each. And you buy two. And you come back and have black tea with them. And I was too proud to tell my wife I was broke. Well, I don't know about being too proud, but I just had this thing. She's dealing with her things. Let me also deal with my things here. I can remember those days. And I was in debt. I owed the bank a lot of money. And somehow every month, I had to find that money. It was like, what, 60 million or something? Yeah. I owed the bank 60 million. And they were not the only ones we owed. Because Flavia had a school loan of $30,000. Today we are debt free. Hallelujah. I look back. I was in a tight situation. I couldn't afford to go see my wife. I couldn't afford to go join her. I had the visa, I had everything, but I couldn't go. But now I can look back. And I went to the US and I entered a house that had no furniture. And today our house is fully furnished. You see, it is remembering those things and reminding myself of those things. Oh, yes. When I can remind myself that, hey, I used to walk through this house and it had nothing. But today it's full. There's good stuff in it. You have to keep reminding yourself of the goodness of God. I look at this fellowship and I thank God. Because I can remember. I remember when it used to be black tea and kabaragara. And a few people, you know. You'd come, meet in the living room and you pray and prophesy over each other and that's it. I can remember, in fact, if I was to trace, honestly, I should trace it all the way back to Kololo. When it was just simply me, Raymond, Robert Chirunda, and Solomon Naveta. Praying every night and prophesying on ourselves every night. By the way, we prophesied. And I can tell you, 90% of those prophecies have already come to pass.
Amen.
But man, those days, I could tell you stories. Many. Today I look and I just lift my hands and I thank God. When I see Solomon flying all over the nations and flying many other people with him to go and work with him, that's amazing. There were times when he would need to go to a mission and he didn't have 30K. Today he can buy tickets for 7-8 guys and take them on a crusade with him. That's the grace of God. That's the goodness of the Lord. We were how many of us? 5, 4, whatever, in a 2-bedroom house. It was squeezed. You know, you know you're poor when you have arguments about who used too much powdered milk. You know, there are some arguments that are just out of poverty. They are not out of anything else. Because if you have surplus, the issue of who puts too much powdered milk in their cup is not a big deal. But when you are counting every little thing, it's a big issue. Naiguni, you're wasteful. Now I can look back and thank God. Amen.
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 My mom's sitting over there. She can tell you. We once used to live in my aunt's house. And it felt like heaven when we moved into a garage. Someone's garage. Seriously. It felt like heaven moving into someone's garage. But the garage door was not properly fixed, so there were holes, and rats used to come in. And then it felt like heaven when we went to a 3-roomed house. Not a 3-bedroomed house, a 3-roomed house. Now that one felt like we'd gone to the Hilton. Then it felt even more glorious when we came to Lungujia. Now there was even space to run around, even though when we came, the grass was this tall. The grass was this tall, the toilet was half broken, you'd balance on one edge. And it never used to flush, so you'd come with a bucket from up here and then you know, so that you create a flushing effect. Couldn't afford to paint the house, so you scrubbed the walls. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You see, remind yourself, bless the Lord and forget not his benefits.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 He has done great things.
Mm.
He has done wonderful things.
Yes.
When I look, I mean, people, for me, I find it amazing that you can come this minute for fellowship and somehow we can get all of you home afterwards. All of you. Which means we fuel the cars, there are people to drive them, and they drive you to your gate, to your door. That's the blessing of the Lord. It is. I mean, I never knew that there would come a time when we can have a fellowship and you feed people, and then it's just these days time became a constraint. Before, you guys remember, we used to have a real chimney. Sometimes even pork, and cocoa, and juice.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Sometimes we'll even have pizza. Those things only change because of time. We didn't become broke. And that's the grace of God, the blessing of God. Bless the Lord and forget not his benefits. Because when you remember what he has done, when you remember where he's brought you from,
oh, yes.
It will deliver you from being a complainer.
Amen.
The Israelites became complainers because they were so quick to forget. They were rejoicing when he delivered them from Egypt. But after a while, they began thinking, but we used to eat fish. They had forgotten that they would eat fish while being lashed every day. When they were eating fish, they were crying for deliverance. But when they got the deliverance, now they are complaining about the fish. We had fish and we had vegetables. We had cucumber. Of all things, I even hate cucumber. Can't stand cucumber. But guys grumbled against God because of cucumber and fish and beef. But the thing is, you can read that stuff and laugh. And not realize that you often the same way. You easily forget what God did for you to bring you to where you are. Then you start complaining about now. You see, I have to think and say thank you, Lord. I have to thank God if I have a fuel problem. Because it means I have a car.
Yeah.
There was a time when a car was a faith issue. Now I have to thank God. At least that's a positive thing. I have. If fuel is a problem, thank you, Lord, I have a car to put the fuel in.
Oh,
hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You might be complaining. You know, it's very interesting. We are so good at complaining and forgetting the blessing. Oh, shabaka stebro seke tabaka. Shetora saka parade sieto mo prede sika. I remember when we used to pray and you would pace the whole night and you're praying and believing God. And among those things, we wanted cars. Then we got cars. And after we got cars, we could no longer pace the whole night. Because now you drive your car in after the praise and worship at around midnight. You pray for, if you're lucky, 2 hours. Then you go into your car to rest. Then you come out again at around 4 for the morning session. And then you don't even finish the morning session and you drive home. The moment it becomes a bit late outside, you drive home. You're like, I might find traffic. Ah. Suddenly the blessing has become an obstacle. You can no longer enjoy God because the blessing has become your obstacle. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
It's very amazing. You meet someone, they've been believing God to get married. Then God gives them the marriage. And after they are married, they can't come to church anymore. They can't come to church anymore. And they're giving you all sorts of excuses. You know my husband, I have to cook for him. You're like, I find it most common in America. America is most amusing. Someone writes to you, no, I need you to pray for me. I am really, really sick. When you come to our city, I'm looking forward. You're going to pray for me. Like, okay, when I come, I'm going to do a meeting at this church and that one. On these days, these ones and this one. You go, you preach there, 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 and they don't show up. Then they send you a message 2 days before you leave. You know, is it possible for you to pass by my place to pray for me? Like, I had meetings here, there, and there. Well, you see, on the other day, my children had a baseball game. Then the other one, it was the birthday party for my little boy. Then the other one, my sister's son was graduating. I left thinking, you know what? One person, I almost wanted to reply to them and tell them, you know what? Keep your disease. And I had to remember to be gracious.
Amen.
But you see, that might sound very far-fetched, but getting there, they didn't get there out of the blue. Mm-hmm. It is gradual.
Yes.
It's very gradual. You begin prioritizing other things over God slowly, slowly, and slowly. Until one day you wake up and you don't even know how to get back to where you once were. You sleep so far down, it looks like a huge climb. It's like exercising. If you used to exercise, then you stop. And after time passes, you consider the pain of starting again. And you're like, Mifudeko. Sometimes I love to joke with people. Because I tell them, I want to know lirakati. Once upon a time, I used to be a green beret in kickboxing. And taekwondo. Now, once upon a time I could put my leg here. Now you tell me to put it here. But those things, they bring, and that's what happens in the spirit too. It's a gradual slide. It's nothing sudden. It's rare for it to be that sudden. For most of us, it's gradual. Even when you see in Romans 1, you could see that their descent into lawlessness is gradual. It starts with being unthankful, the hearts becoming darkened, slowly by slowly, until they are totally taken up, completely. I remember a time when you go to overnight, then you have conversations the whole night outside.
Yeah.
Why did you come? You may as well have stayed home or bought some airtime and just cooked it. But it's gradual. After a while, you become inured to the things of God. These are guys who woke up in the morning and God had put the food of angels on the ground for them. They were excited. What shall we call it? We'll call it manna. Hey, it tastes like cakes. Hey, they're excited about it. Then after a while, all you give us is this manna to eat. We want meat. We want chicken. Some of us look back and are like, man, if I could eat manna. Hey, the food of angels. You eat it and the clothes don't grow old. The shoes do not wear out. Hey! What would it give for my favorite shoes to remain unwrinkled? They just remain the same. You know, I don't know about you other guys, but me, you buy a shoe, and when it's new, you almost want to walk like this. So it doesn't develop those creases. You almost want to change your locomotion. But it's inevitable. At some point, you have to get back to your old way of walking. Someone has to solve that problem, right? Maybe one of you will invent a shoe that even if you bend it, how it still doesn't get wrinkles. But we lose that all over time. If we don't remind ourselves constantly of what God has done, go constantly of his goodness, constantly of his miracles, we'll get to a place where we take him for granted. Hallelujah. Amen. Sometimes I thank God that I'm not here full time. Because when I'm over there and I come back, I am so looking forward to the fellowship. I'm so excited. Because sometimes I imagine that maybe if I was here every week, at some point I would begin to feel like, what's the fellowship? But because, you know, you're aware and you're just looking forward, I start counting weeks. Like, the weeks, like, Uganda's Dayoti. And you count. Then when you're here, the weeks are flying, you're like, they're getting finished quickly. Because there's that expectancy, I come expecting. I'm like, man, God's going to move. He's going to touch us. He's going to do great stuff. And you guys may think me, I walk around, I'm laying hands, you're getting slain. You have no idea. Me, I don't give away without receiving also. That's why you see, when you're laughing, I'm also laughing. I must receive my thing, my dose as well. Sivira mwa. I've decided if I am a pipe, the pipe must get wet. Wet delivering. Hallelujah. An attitude of gratitude. Hallelujah. When Daniel was told no worshiping, the first thing he did was to go and give thanks. He gives thanks and then he ends up with the lions. The lions could not touch a man who lives a life of thanksgiving. When Jehoshaphat is about to go to battle, he puts the choir ahead and they are singing a song of thanksgiving. The moment the thanksgiving rises up, God causes the other army to start fighting itself until they are destroyed. Thanksgiving will make certain things happen for you that all of your praying might not. Sometimes God just wants you to come and say thank you. Actually, all the time, He wants you to come and say thank you. You are so good. You've done so much. I am so grateful. You've given me life. You have given me breath every day. You provide for my needs. I am not sleeping in a box on the street. I actually have a home to live in. I did not sleep hungry last night. You gave me food to eat. I am not naked. I am clothed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I remember one time I was complaining. Like, oh, God. I hate flying.
Wow.
I was really complaining. I hate flying. Complaining about it. Then I had to pray for someone who was believing God for their first flight. And I said, Lord, I take back my words. Thank you for the privilege of flying. Thank you that I don't have to think hard about taking a flight. See, that's a privilege. I thank you for it. It's a great thing. Amen. I thank God for everything now. I thank God that I have good friends. That's a miracle. Hallelujah. You guys don't know. I thank God for Alan. Because I can be in America and I rest. And I know the fellowship is functioning smoothly. My only job is to tune in via live stream and watch. Well, and tell him who is preaching. No, that's about it. I know everything else is working. Smoothly, calmly. I thank God for people like Raymond. I've never had to worry about my house. What for? You keep it better than I would keep it if I was the one. I thank God for him. Everything's fine. You know, and I can tell him on short notice, hey, you're preaching. And I know he always has a word, ready? Even now, if I told him, Jango, he would preach. And it will be good, it will be hot. Hallelujah. It will probably be better than mine. Hallelujah. It's wonderful. Yeah? I thank God. I thank God for friends. I come to Uganda and I have cars in plural. And none of them are mine, by the way. They're like, ah, now. Yeah, I didn't pay a coin for any of them. I just have three cars to pick from. Are they three or four now? I don't know. Yeah. Tufugemweno. Tugenda watu tuwareno neno. That's friendship. I thank God for it. Because I can't say I did anything special to have friends like that. It's just God and His goodness. Hallelujah. So, before you complain, look back and thank God for even being where you are now. God hates complainers. He almost destroyed the whole of Israel just because they were complainers. In fact, Paul writes and says, these things were written for an example to us, so that we are not like them. They were unthankful and it caused them to miss it. And he's saying, do not be like them, because even you, if God, I like how Paul wants, he says, if the ones who were the originals, who could get knocked out, what about you who's just been grafted in? I think he's scared. The other guy has had it by blood. You are by faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I look and I want us to maintain an attitude of gratitude. We thank God for what He has done. Some things are pure friendship. I didn't pay anything for these tarpaulins that are here on the ground. Pure friendship. I call a friend. I'm like, hey, you guys have some tarpaulins. Come and pick as many as you want. Like that. That's simply. Amen. Let's live a life of thankfulness. It will deliver you from complaining. Let me tell you, it's very easy to have a multitude of complaints. Very. And that's normal for any huge church. Then one time I had to ask myself, and I started remembering how I came in, how I just wanted to serve, how I was willing to serve with all my resources regardless. I said, so why am I complaining now? Because those days, I would come to serve, they would give me an assignment, and I don't ask for money, I can't use mine. Now you start complaining, but you see, before you never used to complain about that. But somewhere along the way, it's become an issue. Huh? Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Before, you never had any expectation that if you have trouble, He will bail you out. Now, you think He's responsible for all of your problems and fixing them. How? Lift up your faith, believe God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. You will live such a life of joy when you learn to live a life of thanksgiving. Because you can't fail to be joyous when constantly in front of you, you're seeing the things you have to be thankful for. Thanksgiving creates joy. You will look around and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. A couple of weeks ago, we didn't have a guy who plays sax. Now we have a guy who plays the saxophone.
Amen.
Amen. It's wonderful. Hallelujah. And he plays it so sweetly, you get into the spirit. Hallelujah. Yeah, I thank God. I thank God for him. Jonathan.
Yes.
I didn't leave him here. I found him here. That's beautiful. There are things God just... And if you keep thanking God for them, hallelujah.
Amen.
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 May God deliver you from entitlement.
Amen.
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 Do you know you're not entitled to even anyone's time?
Yes.
When you get rid of the feeling of entitlement, all of your reasons for complaining will go away. I sent you a WhatsApp and you didn't answer me until tomorrow morning. My friend, do you know my schedule? Who am I married to you?
Fire!
But the pastors of these days, hello? Hello? The pastors of these days, my friend. First of all, the pastors of these days, you didn't even have their phone number. You don't find him at church, that's it. Now you even have my WhatsApp number. You can wake me up in the night. Hey, but you're complaining. I took 3 hours to get back to you. Man, guess what? I have a life.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise, you know? I do have a life, outside of listening to all of your things every other minute. It has to be, but there's that attitude of entitlement that we develop. Before you were grateful for what God did for you. Now, man. But Lord, I want this, I want this, I want this. You gave me a car, but now you need to give me fuel, I need to style it up, and maybe you need to do what, eh? And look, when we were young, we used to say, "Kwe mbuzi, kwe nechikono." Hallelujah. Amen.
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 Let God deliver you. Your joy will be so complete when you learn to live in thanksgiving. Every day you look around and you say, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It is wonderful." Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
I was amazed. Let me rebuke some people. Here, after we moved here, my mom went to a lot of trouble to create that little tea room and everything. And someone sent me a complaint about the tea room. And I was thinking to myself, you are entitled to having a tea room in the first place. But you see, it doesn't look so nice. I'm like, hey, what, you want us to tidy it for you? Hey, who told you? I need to touch on something. Some of you, I just need to touch on something. When fellowship would end late, sometimes I used to allow some people to sleep in my house, you know? Then before long, people are complaining about the conditions of sleeping in my house. Man, I just offered you my place to stay. Yeah? You were the ones enjoying the anointing and you made us end late. Then you are complaining, now we need duvets, now we need what? I'm like, bring your own. Yeah. But you know, in the morning, it was not tea for us. That in my chai. You left wondering. And those things. And you see, I'm pointing those out because those are easy to use as examples. But there are other things you can look at in your own life. And you'll be able to see areas where you've become entitled. You've developed a sense of entitlement. Hallelujah. I mean, I thank God for Moses. He shows up and he does, you know, he says, "Oh, so bad, let me iron your shirt." But I cannot be there and complain, "Kare, you did iron my shirt." No, if it's not around, I can iron it. My hands did not stop working. I'm thankful he did. He chooses to do it, you know. But that doesn't mean I start feeling I'm entitled to this guy serving me and doing all these things for me. Amen. Just like sometimes I go places and they don't give me a love offering. I don't complain. Hallelujah. Allah knows, you know. Been places and and you serve and what. And of course, You're taking the whole team with you, so you pay the bills for them, you take care of them, and but for you, you know there's nothing that can be. It's all right. Because you know what? There used to be a time when you would long for a pulpit to even preach on. And you were willing to preach whether you had a love offering or not. Now, you're beginning to think, honey, I'm a government maker. But before, there was a time when just to have the opportunity to preach was a big deal. Now you're wondering, hey, I was amazed. One of my fellow brothers, in that we are sons to Pastor Robert, was telling me that Mose akuwala offering chingo. I was like, it is home.
Yeah.
You know, in case you didn't notice, it is home. I don't expect a love offering when I go to preach at home. I feel privileged that my father can allow me on his pulpit. And when he gives me a love offering, I'm in shock. Like, as one of my desses is so good. Chances are very high, just as I am in sick. But you can get to a place. Now you are too big. I remember one young man, his entire ministry, his music ministry, we saw it grow from there. Then there came a conference. They asked him to come and he said, we want to take our million a seat. In his home church. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Ministers like him are rare. They don't send you a bill and tell you before I come, Zinakuba, where is it? Yeah? May God help you, especially many of you, because God's raising you up. You're going to get to these places. You have no idea. Raymond should tell you, you hear he has flown to the Philippines and you probably think he's in a 5-star hotel. My friend, he almost drowned on this last trip. He was in a house, it rained and the water came and he had to climb into the city. You are thinking the guy is overseas in Asia. You think he's coming back with dollars. Instead, he ended up fixing their house for them. Yes. I go to Peru and I sleep in wooden shacks with mosquitoes biting you the whole night, with diesel on the floor because otherwise creepy crawlies will come in. So they have to pour diesel. So the whole night you're breathing in diesel fumes. Can find me and you think I am high on the Holy Ghost. When I am high on some other thing. No, I'm ready to get a video. Got one of your hallucinations. What? That's ministry. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's how it is. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, some things amuse me. You watch them and you're like, is it a generation that has changed or something? You host some young men in your house and you give them stuff to eat. Then after they're done, they leave the cups and everything on the table. Like, you pick them up and you take them to the sink and you wash them. My friend, let me help you. Because you will travel. When I travel and I go to someone's home, once we are done, I clear up the table and I wash everything. And then I will look around, and if I look outside and their grass is grown, I'll ask them, where is your lawnmower? And I will go there alone. Next time they're eager to have me come back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't come like the mighty man of God. Let me shock you guys. You see 77 dogs, you see Pastor Robert Kanje, everyone serving him. When he comes to America, he comes, eats food in your house and washes his own plate. And yet you even stop him and tell him, no, don't. I says, ah, and he washes it. And you think you're too big. You think you are too big. You're too important. Now you're so big, you need armor bearers. You need armor bearers. As if your phone is too heavy. Your hand can't function anymore. There are things we allow because someone is looking for an opportunity to serve. But that doesn't mean after you allow them that they become an entitlement.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. Because some of us, when you allow certain things, then after a while, you are now entitled to them. You feel like if they are not done for you, you are greatly offended. Let me tell you something. Me, and this is me, I don't need anyone needing to greet me. Amen.
Amen.
I am Noah, and I remain Noah. Amen. That's the name I was given when I was born. Noah Kevin Sematimba. Amen. That's my name. Whether you call me pastor or not, it doesn't change whether I'm anointed or not. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They didn't call me pastor, my friend. Did they baptize you, pastor? Hallelujah.
Amen.
People call me brother, then somewhere else they call you bishop, then you're like, you know, it depends on where you've gone. I go to a white church, they call me Brother Noah. You go to a black American church, they call you Bishop Noah. Like, okay. It's many antiquity about Bishop, but it's okay. If it makes you comfortable, that's fine. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Those things destroy ministries. They destroy ministries completely. There are ministers these days that no one wants to invite because they are a hassle to host. We once hosted a minister who said he only drinks distilled water. We had to go to Bravo to get it. Murago, I mean, that's the only place you could find distilled water.
Okay, Mr. Lambs.
Because we are not about to get Bunsen burners and pipettes and Pyrex glass. Murago. To get him distilled water to drink. I said, Lord. Another one we hosted and they sent us a 1,000-page contract.
Yes.
Full of terms and conditions. 1,000 pages. We had to get a lawyer to read it for us. This how. And when you hear these ministers' stories, they started simple. Somewhere along the way, they lost sight. And this is what gratitude will do for you. It will keep you in mind of where God has brought you from, what he has done. And so you do not develop heirs. Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Be able to be simple. Hallelujah.
Amen.
May God help you. Shabra has taken Musa. Gratitude. Tell your neighbor, attitude of gratitude.
Attitude.
Repeat it, tell them, you need an attitude of gratitude. You need to live a life of gratitude. You need to live a life of thanksgiving. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let me give you a few things. I thank God we are here improving things. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah, thank God. There was once a time, the first time we had sound in the fellowship, it was Adrian who brought a bunch of things from his home. I think this is the first time I met Emma here. Hallelujah. Now today God has blessed us. We have our own things. And we'll keep getting more and more things. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah. Once upon a time, I was standing on other things. Now I'm standing on a carpet. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You thank Him for the small things and the big things.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Yeah, I have to thank God. There was once upon a time when you had to believe God for 100K. Now I thank God that is a meal. Yeah. And you who doesn't yet have it as a meal, don't get jealous, just thank God. And say, Lord, my time is coming also. Eh? You know, my time is coming. Yeah. One day you will be there. But if you are there, doesn't mean that you cannot eat 10K. Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
I can still go to a Kafunda and eat. When I'm in Peru, there are no restaurants. Huh? You eat some strange things. Mwogo musike. They call it what? Yuka. And some interesting things, because they are the only things you can risk eating. Some of the other things are very interesting. You don't want to risk. The idea of eating piranha. You know, they're carnivorous fish and they're very bony. You even wonder what they're eating off of the fish. But they enjoy it. Somewhere in the Cameroon Highlands, those guys in Malaysia, in the Aboriginal tribes, they have certain worms they like eating. And they eat them when they are fermented a little bit. In Nigeria, they have this dish called stockfish. That those stockfish, they first let it get spoiled a little bit before they cook it. When they eat it in the house, you can smell those guys for like days afterwards. I pastored a Nigerian church. They would come having eaten stockfish and they want hugs. Would come excited to see the pastor. They are just running to you and you can smell them from the other end. And you hold your nose and you hug them. Hallelujah. Hey. Paul put it this way. He said, I know how to abase and how to abound. And in all of it, he remains content. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know how to abase and how to abound. So when I go to Java, I need for dinner. I can also go to Java's or Serena, for that matter. Amen. You know, some people think Java's is high end. It's actually a mid low end. Hallelujah. Yeah, I might be going for chicken biryani at Handy. One of my favorites. Oh. I might be going for the other chapati at Rubanda. Obeyan put a CK by the roadside. Power and look up. Amen. An attitude of gratitude. Break the sense of entitlement off of your life. Amen.
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 It has also helped me. It will help you avoid disappointments.
Yeah.
Because I've had people who come to you and say God has told them to partner with you. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, then somewhere. What happened? What God said? But because I don't have a sense of entitlement, every time it comes, I'm like, thank you, Lord. When they stop, you're like, oh, well, it was nice while it lasted. God will bring someone else. He will provide you whichever way He wants. Huh? I've had people come and tell you, the Lord told me, I'm supposed to do this and this for you. You're like, okay. Then you wait. Nothing happens. But if you don't have a sense of entitlement, you're like, ah, thank you, Lord. Either way, you are Jireh, not them. It is you I trust, not human beings. You will do it whichever way you choose to. If the person promised and they didn't come through, it's all right. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.